In progress.
Hey, what's up, guys? I'm back again. I'm naturally doing a double video because I know I really got to get this thing all done. But fortunately, I only have probably one or two more videos after this one. So this time, I'm going to be finishing out the regular season with UH's last road trip for the season, in which they went to Santa Barbara and CSUN, and they came away with a split. But first of all, as usual, I'd like to show you all my print story from a little over a year ago. And this time we'll be discussing this part here, their last road trip against Santa Barbara and CSUN. Now, how did I think they'd do? I thought they would split the road trip, and I was right. How did I think that would happen? I thought they might compete with Santa Barbara, but I kind of doubted that. But I kind of put an L in there because I didn't, because Santa Barbara is a hell of a team, and to get a win over them is a big accomplishment, and they did so in the home matchup. They rallied back from 19 down. But unfortunately, they weren't as fortunate as they were at their place. I thought they would fall to Santa Barbara and win at CSUN, because CSUN is kind of around the middle. Santa Barbara is around the top. And of course, because of COVID, that was a bit of a, I wouldn't say complete role reversal, but certainly a role reversal for Santa Barbara, because they were down near the middle of the conference. So that's, you already saw my print story. So let's get started. I'm going to start sharing my screen here. So we're going to start here with UC Santa Barbara. They fought hard, only to be bounced by Santa Barbara. And what really stung about this game, it says so right here, UH had 9 triples. Santa Barbara had only 1. And that lone triple for them came in the first half. So that was pretty disappointing. And of course, the opening statement here, the best they can do is split on the road, which is true. But unfortunately, that's the best they can do. And to make matters worse, because of the loss to UC Santa Barbara, that eliminated UH from possibly winning the Big West season, making second place the best they can do. But the fact that they were able to compete with Santa Barbara, that certainly spoke a lot of volumes to just how resilient that the team truly is. And as you can see, shooting at even 50%, but Santa Barbara, they did a little better on field goals, and that's where I thought that Santa Barbara got UH in, at least one of the areas anyway. Because UH, they had 22 field goals, Santa Barbara had 26. And despite 9 triples, as you saw in the sub headline, second headline, UH had 9 triples, Santa Barbara only 1. And another area where I thought really told the story, Santa Barbara, they were 14 of 16 from the free throw line for 87.5%. I just think they were a little more aggressive than the Bows were. But Kamaka Hepa did come back, prove that he's back to normal. He led everyone with 19 points and 7 boards. Jerome DeRozier, another great performance with 15, and he was also 3 of 6 from 3-point range. Jovan McClanahan, not much else you can say about him. He's been a hell of a factor on offense, that's for sure. He had 13 points, and he had 6 assists. But this was kind of, but this first, but without Noel Coleman, this started to become the norm. They would start out kind of slow in the first half after making the first basket. And then they would kind of go quiet for a while, and then they'd have to pick it up. But that's what happened here. Gauchos got turned it up with an 11-0 run pretty much right out of the gate. But this is another problem that UH has been having. They've been having a lot of turnovers. And in the first half, they ended up with 14. Santa Barbara did better, albeit 10. And that's what killed UH for sure during that three-game skid they were under. But fortunately, UH didn't let them get away, which is a good thing. And for me to say that, that's because I had to follow this game, and they certainly kept Santa Barbara in sight. And if they can do that, they can give themselves a chance at the win. So, fortunately, UH found a rhythm of their own with a 9-2 run thanks to a Jerome DeRozier triple, and that cut their lead, and that cut Santa Barbara's lead down to 2 points, 13-11. And then UH uncorks an 11-0 run of their own, starting with two Hepa triples. And after another triple from DeRozier with 7.5 to go, they got the lead. And you'd think that they would be able to hold on until the very end. And they did until the end of the first half anyway. And unfortunately, they would kind of get clear sailing. All they had to do was just play well and respond to every run that Santa Barbara made. This happened. The turnovers started coming back. Unfortunately, both teams exceeded 10, but Santa Barbara unfortunately did better with 10 turnovers exactly. But this part here, no free throws in the first half, I thought that also played a factor as well. Because there have been times where UH has been held to zero free throws all game long. And they almost were against UC San Diego because they only had one free throw attempt, which was a miss from Junior Madu. In the second half, they've been really good coming out of halves, as Coach Aaron Gannat said. And this was another example. You know what I mean? They hit a triple almost immediately from Jerome DeRozier to take the lead. Or excuse me, to keep their lead, I should say. And this second half, there were a couple of scoring drops that really, really hurt them. But fortunately, they did keep them in sight, as I said. But this only added insult to injury. This flagrant foul on McClanahan just added insult to injury. But fortunately, UH did show their resilience. They tied it up twice. But unfortunately, they just couldn't get in front. They did not get in front. But they did come back within a point with 2:25 to go, thanks to Hepa. And it's almost impossible for Kamaka to have a bad game in terms of triples. At least that's what I see anyway. But they did much better in the second half. UH did. Three turnovers committed. They hit five triples. Santa Barbara, zero triples. I don't know how many turnovers that they had. In fact, they had only four. Three turnovers committed for the Bows, five triples. Santa Barbara, zero triples, four turnovers. But the fact that it just wasn't enough for UH just really, really stung. let me tell you. But Gannat said that they're a good team, and they're a team that was picked to win the Big West. But this guy here, Josh Pierre-Louis, he's one of their guys that can certainly lead this team really well. And they got another big guy in Amadou Sow that can certainly wreak a lot of havoc for the team. And they also have Miles Norris out there as well. And he was a hell of a factor too, and so was AJ Mitchell. But this game, three times this season, the Bows are out-rebounded. This was number three. They had one time where they tied, and that was UC Davis. And they're a hell of a team too. But they've proven that they've got the luck. But they had some good luck over them, Davis, and I was surprised that they lost to them, to be honest. But the fact that the Gauchos outscored the Bows in just about every other statistical category, it does make it a little deceiving. But if you saw how catch in close proximity, that makes this paragraph pretty misleading in a way. And although that UH ended up losing, this part here really cushioned the blow. Cal Poly beat UC Irvine. And just when you thought that was key there, because for UH to maintain third place, they got a break coming there. They got another break with Cal Poly turning back UC Irvine 65-54. That's the thing. Okay, so that hurt, and now we'll talk about this one. UH dominated Northridge. They won by 7 at home, and they won by 22 at their place. And they also made some history along the way, as you can see here, with Aaron Gannat's 113th win in his 7-year tenure at UH. And Gannat is a hell of a coach, and I got to be honest, University of Hawaii would be crazy nuts to let him go. And despite losing Noel Coleman, they still pull off three wins in the Final Four, which I thought that they would do regardless. But making history at the same time, hey, that's your reward. And of course, they won CSUN 84-62. And that win for Gannat was win number 113, which moves him past former UH head coach Red Rocha. I have only heard little bits and pieces about him, but anybody who's followed UH basketball as long as I have, they would probably know him, because I followed this team for 26 years, 25, 26 years, and Red Rocha I hadn't heard about. So anyway, UH did well. They hit 25 field goals to 21 for CSUN. But the fact that they were a lot more proficient from three-point range in the second half of this game than they were in the home matchup certainly spoke volumes. And this was the team, when CSUN came here, this was the team that UH managed to defeat, despite them only committing four turnovers in that home matchup overall. Of course, Junior Majut, his tenure at UH is winding down. Look what he does. 18 points, 6 rebounds, and 1 block. And Kamaka Hepa with another good game. Bernardo Da Silva and Amaro Lotto coming out with double-digit gains as well. And they're going to need a lot. And when they come into the tournament, they're definitely going to, with Noel down, they were going to need a lot more points from Da Silva and Lotto. And this was the game where they did. It was an evenly matched first half, but UH managed to get on a significant run right away. Excuse me. They got an UH went on a 9-2 run to get the lead with 10:41 remaining. So Kylan Reins hit a triple. But Adam Wright is a guy on CSUN that I think is a hell of a baller. And UH had a 7-point lead with 25 seconds to go until a layup from Wright put Northridge within 5 to end the first half. But this was the game where I thought UH really put it together for turnovers because they only had 3 in the first half. And they did well in the second half with only 4 to tie their season low 7 turnovers that they did at Illinois-Chicago. And, of course, Northridge came out firing in the second half, but UH managed to respond. And although CSUN tied for the lead, UH managed to get it back off a foul from Anya Aisi. And this is a guy who I don't think we saw any action from him in the home matchup. I think he was out with COVID protocols. I'm not sure. But anyway, this was what the Bows needed. And Aisi fouled De Silva, and UH pulled away from then on. From that point on, once UH managed to extend their lead to 10, I knew it was over. And this run right here, 26-5, that told the story. And Christian Gray is another one of CSUN's players that can certainly do a lot of damage. And he ended up fouling out. He ended up with being ejected with two technical fouls, and 3 other Matadors had fouled out. And as I said earlier, 7 turnovers overall, that ties their season low. But Northridge, I don't know if he can do anything about Wright and his leads and his scoring, because this guy was a hell of a player that night, that's for sure. But once again, UH found themselves. They outscored CSUN in every other statistical category besides steals. Northridge had 5, UH had only 4. But they were still relatively but everything was still pretty much even in the first half, but second half was all UH, that's for sure. I was very glad to see that too. And this win, they locked up the third seed. Because honestly, I thought that they could get second, but Fullerton, their lead scorer, EJ Anasicki, he's a hell of a player, and I'll explain that in the next video. So anyway, up next is the Big West tournament. And as it turns out, they were going to face off against the same team that bounced them in the tournament the year before, UC Riverside. But the fact that Fullerton won over Davis 62-59 kind of took away a chance at second place. And as I said in the last video, UH was picked to finish second in the Big West tournament or the Big West season this year. But I think second place, I think they can pull it off. But third place, I'm going to say this right now, third place is the worst that they'll do. I feel it. So anyway, we're going to stop sharing here. So anyway, that was it. UH managed to lock up third place where I predicted. So they certainly made me look like a genius too. And they made me look more like a genius because the answer was 17-11 overall. Although I did think they would be 17-11 going into the tournament. And I'll explain that in the next video. So for now, thanks for watching. Malama Pono, and I'll see you all again.